Layer 1.
Types of string theory.
In string theory, there are 5 so-called consistent formulations or flavors. There's type 1, there's type 2A, type 2B, heterotic SL32, and heterotic E8 cross E8. Type 1 string theory is characterized by open and closed strings with the gauge group SO32 coming from something called the Chan-Paton factors at the endpoints of the open strings. Type 2A and type 2B are both closed string theories, with type 2A being non-chiral and type 2B actually being chiral. The heterotic string theories are based on a hybrid of 26-dimensional bosonic string theory and a 10-dimensional superstring theory, also resulting in closed strings. Heterotic actually means hybrid. You can always sound clever to someone studying string theory by saying, "Oh, do you study heterotic strings?" They'll respect you exactly 3% more.
Open and closed strings.
As mentioned before, there are broadly 2 types of strings: open strings, which have endpoints, and then there's closed strings forming loops. This formula on screen is specific to closed strings and accounts for additional properties such as the winding number W and momentum N in a compactified space. Compactified spaces are something that we'll explore later, so don't worry if this terminology confuses you. R is the compactification radius, and alpha prime is called the regislope. These will come up over and over. By the way, the regislope is related to the so-called string tension. All of these we'll discuss in detail later.
M theory.
The 5 flavors of string theory are related through something called dualities, such as T-duality connecting type 2A with type 2B, and then there's S-duality linking type 1 with heterotic SO32. The fact of these dualities is what spurred the idea of M-theory, which is an 11-dimensional unifying framework encompassing all 5 string theories, rather than a 10-dimensional theory. It does so by introducing a new type of brain called a membrane, which we'll talk more about later. By the way, when someone says that string theory is in 10 dimensions, they actually mean 9 plus 1, so 9 spatial dimensions and 1 time dimension. And when they say it's 11-dimensional, they mean 10 plus 1. The reason is they're usually talking about space-time dimensions as a whole. Apparently, the M in M theory stands for a matrix or membrane or mystery or mother, but I think it stands for an upside-down W for Witten, much like how the W of Wario is an upside-down M for Mario.
Left and right moving strings.
String modes are characterized by their oscillations along the world sheet and are described by the Polyakov action on screen. Notice I keep saying mode and not vibration. That's because no string theorist talks about vibrations unless they're being condescending to a lay public. Generally, they speak about modes, or even spectra, which are distinct states of a string, each with their own quantum number like energy, charge, mass, spin, winding number. If you introduce light cone coordinates, which you'll see on screen as sigma plus and minus, again on the world sheet, then you can separate that Polyakov action into left and right moving components, leading to the Fourier expansions on screen. It may sound confusing, but this is akin to decomposing a complex function into a real and imaginary part. The energy momentum tensor, TAB, also decomposes into left and right moving components, T++ and, say, T-, which generates something called the Virasoro algebra. This allows us to classify, or label, our states into conformal weights. Personally, I like to denote the right-moving conformal dimension with a tilde, as there's already one too many h-bars in physics. There's another subtlety here of matching left and right mode numbers in order to preserve Lorentz covariance, but the iceberg must go on.
Gravitons.
Gravitons are the hypothesized massless spin 2 particles said to be responsible for gravitation. They come from rank 2 tensor field perturbations h mu nu. Now all of that's a mouthful, but I could have just said it's a massless spin 2 particle. Why? Because there are theorems by Weinberg and others that suggest the particle associated with gravity would have those properties. And furthermore, any particle that's massless, chargeless, and spin 2 would be the particle of gravity. Thus, they're equivalent. You get this by linearizing the Einstein field equations around a flat background metric, giving the equation on screen. This is the aforementioned perturbation. It should be mentioned that no one has observed a graviton, and furthermore, we have great reasons to believe that we never will, even in principle. This is a point that Freeman Dyson makes. Thus, it's unclear if the graviton is even a scientific concept in the Popperian sense.
Dualities in string theory.
You'll hear T and S dualities discussed frequently. T-dualities are transformations like R moving to something like being proportional to the inverse of R, where R represents the compactification radius and alpha prime is the Reggie slope. This connects type 2A and type 2B superstring theories. How so? It maps a type 2A theory on a circle of radius R to a type 2B theory on a circle of radius alpha prime over R, and vice versa. S-duality, on the other hand, explores the equivalence between weak and strong couplings in string theory. It's particularly evident in the SL2Z invariance of type 2B string theory, which acts on a complex parameter combining the string coupling GS and certain Raymond-Raymond fields. By the way, I've heard this pronounced Raymond, I've heard this pronounced Raymond. I'm just going to stick with Raymond. This makes it only slightly more difficult than taking the inverse of GS. This S-duality links type 1 string theory with heterotic SO32 theory, which then gives insights into non-perturbative string dynamics, since strong couplings are useful for non-perturbative studies and weak ones for perturbative. The other S and T dualities are shown on screen. S duality hinges on incorporating elements like D-brains and oriental folds. Basically, you can think of both of these dualities as inversions. One inverts the coupling strength, and the other inverts the radius of the extra dimensions after compactifying. Heterotic strings. Confession, I deceived you earlier, out of kindness and love, when I told you that there are 5 flavors of string theory that are 10-dimensional. There are actually several more than that. One of them, even the original string theory, is 26-dimensional and only described bosons, not fermions. And most of the matter that we see is fermionic, where the bosons are there to allow interactions between them. Heterotic string theory combines left-moving bosonic modes from the 26-dimensional bosonic string theory with right-moving fermionic modes from a 10-dimensional superstring theory. This abomination is gotten to by compactifying 16 additional dimensions in the left-moving sector on an internal lattice, resulting in 2 consistent heterotic theories, the SO32 and the E8 cross E8. But what do we mean by consistent here? What do we mean by super here? Is a superstring a string that's been bitten by a radioactive spider? We'll explore that in one of the deeper layers. The short answer is yes. With more detail, let's use some notation on screen here to represent the root lattice. So here it's VE8 of the E8 Lie algebra, and the heterotic theories are defined by their lattices through this construction. You'll notice here that 26 equals 10 plus 8 plus 8, though you'll also notice that 26 does not equal 10 plus 32. The reason is that you don't deal with the group SO32 directly. You don't even deal with its 16-dimensional root lattice. Instead, you deal with the weight lattice of spin 32 modded out by Z2. Reggie slope. The Reggie slope, denoted by A prime, is a fundamental parameter in string theory that relates the mass squared of a string to its angular momentum J through the linear Reggie trajectory written on screen. Susskind covers this in the first lecture on string theory at Stanford, and the link to that is in the description. This trajectory represents the spectrum of excited string states as a relationship between mass and angular momentum. Personally, I think that the word trajectory is misleading since it implies that something is moving through space, but rather this is a plot of an observed pattern of quantum numbers. The Reggie slope is inversely proportional to string tension, T, with A prime equaling something proportional to the inverse of T. For those quantum field theorists interested in scattering amplitudes, the Reggie trajectory comes from the analytic continuation of the amplitude into the complex angular momentum plane, where the physical region corresponds to the poles of the amplitude. This means considering angular momentum as a complex number, rather than just an integer or a half integer as a standard in quantum mechanics. By the way, you can also formulate the Reggie slope as the square of the string's length. And if you'd like a breakdown of natural units, I have a 2-hour lecture series breaking down this topic. Link is in the description. World sheet symmetry. The world sheet of a string is the 2-dimensional surface that a string sweeps out in space-time shown on screen here. The basic symmetries of the world sheet include reparameterization invariance and then something called Weyl symmetry. Be careful not to call it Weyl symmetry. If you do, string theorists will respect you exactly 3% less. Reparameterization invariance means you can choose whichever coordinates you like on the world sheet and it won't affect the physical predictions. Weyl symmetry is the rescaling of the world sheet metric, which is a feature in conformal field theories, or CFTs. CFTs are something that we'll explore next. Recall the Polyakov action here. This little guy is invariant under both reparameterization and Weyl transformations.
conformal symmetry and the Polyakov action.
Conformal symmetry means when you scale the metric, you preserve angles. This means that while your volume can change, like the volume of a circle, the shape doesn't, like the shape of the circle is the same.
The fact of this symmetry allows us to simplify calculations in that juicy Polyakov action before. The G here is the regular space-time metric that we know and love, and the H is the world sheet metric. This symmetry leads to a vanishing of the trace of the angular momentum tensor, yielding the Virasoro constraints, which are important when talking about the so-called string quantization.
Conformal symmetry also allows us to decompose into holomorphic and anti-holomorphic correlators, thus reducing calculations into far simpler one-dimensional CFTs.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy.
Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.